different speakers have come and delivered the water talk to us. Not only that, it's a matter of great privilege that two of the speakers who had come to our water talk was awarded Padma Award last year. One of them, Mr. Poppanla Pawar, got Padma Shri Award, and Dr. Anil Joshi got Padma Bhushan Award. And then we went on to the dialogue with district magistrates. Every Saturday from 3:30 to 6 p.m., we have a live interaction with 4 to 5 selected district magistrates and one or two NGOs who are working on the water sector, just to know the feedback from the ground and also to encourage the district magistrates in taking up water-related activity and to make this water as a part of their agenda. Because as district magistrates, many of them are doing a lot of other things, law and order issues, vaccination drive, COVID patients, all these things are part of their main agenda. So water generally left in the background. Make district magistrates involved in the water conservation works and to encourage and to make let them showcase their works. We started this dialogue with DM Kasturain, going on well. And last one is about the big campaign, which is on the Catch the Rain campaign with the tagline, Catch the Rain, Where It Falls, When It Falls. It is a simple campaign, Catch the Rain, Where It Falls, When It Falls. Rain ko pagdo, jahan barse, jab bhi barse. And I'm very happy to inform that this has really picked up all over the country. We have many banks, almost 1,000 branches of the, more than 10,000 branches of the various banks displaying this our IEC materials in their branches. We have had Jal Shapath taken all over the country by more than 15 lakh people, took this on January 1st. On importance of conservation of water, the tremendous multiplier effect we have got due to the involvement of Nehru Yuva Kendra is very 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 interesting, because they have the presence in all the districts, and from December 21st, ever since the campaign awareness generation campaign has been launched by the honorable ministers for Jal Shakti and the minister for youth affairs from Delhi, following the Nehru Yuva Kendra Sangathan, our reach has increased manifold times, because every district we have a presence, every district magistrates are getting involved. Not only that, the enthusiastic workers and the youths of the Nehru Yuva Sangathan had been involving people, local representatives, sarpanchas, water warriors, children, youth, everybody in this campaign. And to facilitate them, we had organized trainings from January 2nd to February 7th. The National Water Mission and our technical associates, Terry, etc., were joined. Fasia, madam, was there. I don't know. They all have of us had joined for a 2-3 hours training session. Every day from January 22nd to almost February 7th, continuously, we had one state or if it's the largest state, or two or three states if they are smaller states, like from the Northeast and all the Union Territories. We had presence of every district, people, officials from every district. And we had about 2 to 3 hours intensive training on the various aspects of rainwater harvesting, on various IEC materials on the rainwater harvesting, such on the IEC activities, and also on reporting mechanism. So this has really gone beyond what we had anticipated. It's really very good reach we have got to the people. This is in addition to the involvement of the institutions like Army, Air Force, Navy, airports, railways, central universities, IITs, IIMs, etc., who have joined us as an institution, central paramilitary forces. All of them have joined us as an institution about 3-4 months back for the campaign. So this institutional support joining with my institute and as well as from the Nehruva Kendra people spreading to all over the country, and the message going through the banks, through the other social media platform, really boosted up this campaign. But coming to the today's talk is actually a part of the technical series, because the water talks and the dialogues with DMs are basically addressing the water warriors and the people who are in the field, who are activists in the field, who want to do something for the for conservation of water, and very good results are there. But then we also thought that just Gatta Godhana and making water harvesting structures need not just be the end all of all the campaigns which we do. We'll have to make our engineers, the technical people, also understand the latest things going on in the field. The latest cutting edge technologies should be there. So we have had people from Israel coming in the first water talk. Then we had Dr. Rajesh Sinha from the IIT Kanpur coming up and talking on in the second water talk. Then we had Dr. Pradeep from the IIT Madras on harvesting for clean water, that is from the atmospheric generation of water. Very, very new topics. But then we are proud to be Atmanirbhar Bharat, where our own people, our own scientists have developed this technology, nothing less than the technologies of Israel and other foreign countries. We have developed, and Dr. Pradeep and his team had been championing the cause of generating water from the atmosphere, particularly suitable for areas where there is problem of water, of electricity and power. So that is going on well. And also we had last time Mr. Austin Ekenjern from the IVL, Swedish Environmental Research Institute, talking about the reuse, recycle of water and what are the new technologies available for cleaning up of these sewage water and the wastewater. Today, we have another very eminent person, Dr. Indra Shekhar Sen, a homegrown researcher who have done a lot of work in the quality segment of the water. Because, you know, when the one of the major problem of the water in India, of course, is about the water management is a main issue. The quantity is one issue. We can address that quantity issue, but then another major issue which we try to sweep under carpet is the quality of water. Even though we have sufficient water available, one liter of dirty water can spoil liters and liters of quality, good quality water, potable water. More than that, there are a lot of diseases spread in India due to poor quality water. Many children die, stunting happens, their development is very much affected, and many diseases, diarrhea and all other diseases spread to the poor quality of water. So, but then we should know whether the water we drink or whether the tube well which we have in our compound, all the well which we have in the sort of them collect water from generally swept under the carpet. But now, health being a very important subject, after COVID particularly, people have become more and more conscious of their health and the issues associated with it. Pradhan Mantri ji has also started his Ayushman Bharat, and the trust, you can notice the trust given in the for the health sector with the very enlarged, enhanced allocation in the present budget, all indicates that health is of prime concern now. And what is more important than water to take care of the basic health? Water quality checking. Even though there are many, many agencies like CPS, Center Pollution Control Board, State Pollution Control Board are existing, they are all very complicated equipments are available. But Dr. Sen has come up with very, very innovative technologies for people to check about the quality of water. Because water quality checking has its own issues associated with this. Collection of sample is very important. How to store that sample, how to transport is that sample from different locations to the center location, and from there to the lab, and then come back with the report. It takes a lot of time. And in that process, many times the water which we are bringing are very poor quality, and we make it effective. So this is where Dr. Sen has come out with this very, very innovative approach on taking quality of water. He is a very, very distinguished person. He has one. He is presently working as assistant professor in the Institute of Kanpur. He is also the visiting faculty from 2013-14 was the visiting faculty of IIT Bhubaneswar. Earlier that, a long-term guest investigator for Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution in USA. He has his postdoctoral scholarship fellow from the Department of Marine Chemistry and Geochemistry, Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution in USA. Doctoral evidence acquisition fellowship from Florida International University. A stream of academic brilliance and qualification goes with that. And also, he had won several prestigious awards, including Young Scientist Award from the Ministry of Mines in 2016, Inter-DST Mission Mode Project for Developing Real-Time Water Quality Monitoring Platform for River Ganga. He is also the 2020 New India Challenge. He won that award for the NITI AIYOG. And so many publications he have. And here we have Dr. Sen, would be talking to us, Indra Shekhar Sen from IIT, from the Department of Earth Sciences, IIT Kanpur, talking about looking at the quality, the emerging trends on new paradigms in water quality monitoring. Over to Dr. Indra Shekhar Sen. Thank you.
And I completely agree. I always say that too much water of poor quality is also of no use, and a very little water of very good quality is also no use. So both quality and quantity, should really go hand in hand. One is almost useless than the others. But unfortunately, the quality part is often overlooked, and absolutely, sir, is correct. And that's where we started. We moved back to India in 2014, and since then we are actively working on water quality issues. All right. So is my screen visible?
Yes, it's good.
Okay. So I would talk about new paradigms in water quality monitoring, how it's done at the present moment, and what there lies for us in the future. And at the same time, I would also highlight, because Kanpur, as is right on the heart of the Indo-Gangetic Plain, and the Ganga is flowing right, within 5 kilometers of our campus. Our group has extensively worked on the Ganga, and so first I would like to start my talk on some of the very interesting work that we have done on the River Ganga and so on. But this is my a slide which all climate scientists, geologists, earth scientists that love to use. So this last 100 years, it's a time frame of really unprecedented changes in our lifetime. Of course, this talk is relevant to water, but I would just like to draw your attention that it is not really the water. Every aspect has changed. You talk about global mean sea level. As you can see, it has gone up, and that's why a lot of the coastal areas are getting inundated. Arctic sea ice area, which is kind of diminishing day by day, and the recent example, as you see in the Chamoli, where there was a big flood. Of course, there are multiple reasons behind it, but our Himalayan glaciers are melting, which also has downstream a lot of effects on the water resources. You know, similarly, the heat content of the ocean, which is causing global warming, sea surface temperature has gone up, and every aspect, every domain you see, you know, where, you know, the ocean surface pH has gone up, which is a big problem, which we called, scientists call us ocean acidification. So these are, you know, there, every aspect, every environmental factors, what you see, it is there. And so as our water. And I would just like to highlight, you know, these, when you talk to an earth scientist, we talk about scales of millions of years. And this is not really millions of years, it's like in our lifetime, you know, my great grandmother, my father, you know, my, you know, daughter, the, you know, they are actually seeing a very different climate. And I'm sure it's, they are also seeing a very different water, you know, quality aspect. So let me see. How do I go to the next slide? Yeah. So I think let's start focusing on the water quality aspect. And, you know, again, when we talk about water quality, it's there, the groundwater, you know, we can talk about river water, we can talk about lake water, pond water. But just give you, you know, I'm sure this the community who are listening to us today, you know, they are well aware of the water quality. But just to give you some facts that, you know, these are the number of breaches in groundwater quality that happened over the last few years. And this is data from the World Resource Institute. And as you will see that, you know, there are multiple times the breaching happened, you know, and it's everywhere. It is not that only a particular locality of the country is facing that. It's like, you know, almost randomly distributed in the entire country. So it is indeed, you know, a really alarming situation. And at the same time, if we talk about our rivers, again, this is just a map on the background where you can see the, you know, the biological oxygen demand level, which is usually has to be less than 3 milligrams per liter to be fit for drinking. And you just look at those numbers, 63, 26, 7, 56, you know, they are really on the higher side. But said so, you know, I would also like to draw your attention to some of the good aspects of it, you know, because, you know, as an academician, you know, when we say that, you know, our river is the dirtiest, the chances of getting it published is the highest because, you know, people like this kind of stories. So, you know, over the last 6 years, you know, we actually did a lot of work on the Ganga River. And because, you know, it's a really important source of water for the entire northern part of India. So, say, given this backdrop, I would kind of outline my talk in this way. I will talk about the River Ganga in terms of water quality, that what we have learned over the last 6 years, 7 years of my stay in India. And then, of course, I will talk about current practices in water quality monitoring, which Ashok sir kindly briefed a little bit. You know, it's a very complicated way of how we are doing. And then I would come to the new paradigm that how what we can do, you know, how it can be done so that it's a much easier and smarter way. So let's start about the, you know, if you really, you know, just Google up, you know, Ganga water quality and COVID-19, you know, there are so many newspaper articles, you know, and there's a plenty, you know, it's just pages after pages. And, you know, being situated right on the bank, we saw that this is also a great opportunity to, you know, do things correctly, properly, and, you know, interpret it well. So we looked into this study, I think, which is very important, and it's a very strong matches that I have given to the community that, you know, let's look at the questions we are asking here. You know, what was the impact of COVID-19 on Ganga River water quality? If you read newspaper article, you will say it has improved, it has, or it has not improved, you know, on a binary, you know, 0 to 1 format. And then what controls the variability? Because it is very important for us to understand that what actually controls their, you know, their chemistry. Because unless we know that, it's very difficult to understand what controls the quality. And then even if we remove all anthropogenic, you know, any disturbance from our side, you know, how much resilience is there in the water quality parameters? How quickly, you know, it will kind of react to, you know, changes in the policy, in the system, so that we all, you know, we see the Nirmal Ganga again. So there are multiple questions that, you know, it is very obvious question that we can always ask. And then, you know, that was the backdrop. And I'll tell you what are the complications in it and where we are not doing it correctly. So if you really look at, you know, of course, this is a just an XY plot, lot of colors, lot of numbers, but don't worry about it. What you just look at is basically the, you know, the trends. You know, for example, you know, if I look at, say, calcium, what you see is the calcium concentrations on your X-axis. You have just time. It is nothing but a time versus concentration plot. So you see just calcium has gone down. Now, if you really don't understand the system well, you will say, look, COVID-19 has decreased the calcium level in the water. And similarly, look at magnesium. Look, magnesium has simply, you know, increased the concentration of magnesium and on the water. So it is not that simple, because one thing which we fail to realize is this blue color, which is the precipitation. So any time we talk about quality, that means concentration. Concentration, the unit says milligram per liter. So I'll give you a simple example. You have one glass of water with 10 ions in it, and now you evaporate half of it. So now still your half a glass will still have those 10 ions. So in that way, you actually have increased the concentration twice without even doing anything. It's the same glass of water, only half of the, you know, the half of the water evaporated and your concentration. So now when you report it, the concentration looks like twice as much as what it should be. But what we always fail to kind of include is this, the amount parameter, because the amount and the concentration are linked. We cannot interpret a concentration data without knowing what is the volume of water in the river. And as for, say, in the groundwater system or in the on the lakes, on the ponds. So, and that's a major problem, because just looking at these trends, if you really say that, you know, my river water has, you know, the quality has improved or the quality has decreased, you know, it's a purely wrong statement. And I will show you, this is just a kind of animation. I think the animation is kind of, I cannot play this animation out here. Let me see. Yeah. So it's just a, you know, animation where, you know, if I played this animation, you would see that this is, you know, to me out here, what you see is the Amazon River. It's the map of South America is kind of very big. And this map changes with change in water volume. So the sun position is basically, that's just, you know, the summertime. You know, there's a lot of water out here. So the, you know, that's how it's almost like a breathing planet, I would say. You know, if the animation was there.
Okay, same. Probably you can share the video. If you go to that file, share the option, we'll be able to use the video.
What to do? Share, I think there is this
file. Share option, isn't it? Share,
including video.
That's it?
No, I cannot see this.
Anyway, that's not the problem. But what I'm trying to say, that you see India out here. This is the winter time India. It's really small, because the water, it's a map of volume of water, how it's shrinking and enlarging. And that's why you see India in the winter time, it's very small. That's because the water discharge is very low on the rivers. And in compare, this is in the southern hemisphere, you have a lot of water. And when the sun moves on the north, you know, this portion, you know, will kind of enlarge, because that's the volume, you know, that's what the monsoon time, you know, the melting of the glacier, and this will shrink. So what I was trying to put the point, that the concentration is a function of the volume, the one we measure, milligram per liter. Everything remains same. In your summer time, the concentrations would be much higher compared to monsoon time, because in monsoon times, because of the heavy precipitation, everything gets diluted. So so that's what we called it, something called the C by Q plot, that is the concentration discharge plot, which actually takes care of all these things. I'm not going into very technical details, but you know, if you have questions, you can write to me. But we always have to look concentration in terms of the volume of water. So what you see here, again, these are colorful plots. What you see, if it's a pure dilution, that means you have half a glass of water and on top of it, you put, you know, half a glass more, then it will be a simple dilution where the concentration will almost reduce to half. So looking at all these things, you know, we actually figured out that the changes what we see during the COVID-19 lockdown was very subtle, but still you can figure it out. And also the other thing out here, what we see is a calcium by sodium by magnesium by sodium plot. And it's a classical 101 geochemistry plot where we, you know, try to, because ultimately the river receives its ions from rocks. The rocks weather, and you know, which are the rocks? There are silicate rock like, you know, granite, basalts, evaporites, and then you have carbonates on this side. So the river water chemistry is basically a function of rock weathering on land. So if you have really good understanding of these two parameters, what are the natural controllers and what are the controllers, how the control is, controlled by the discharge, then only you will be able to interpret temporal data. Don't interpret any temporal data just looking at trends. Goes up means, you know, the concentration increase, goes down, that means, and that is 99% of the data is interpreted like this way, which is quite a pity. So that's what we, you know, kind of did, and then what we looked into is, it's a very interesting finding, and I'll walk you through each of these slides. So let's look at the central slides, which is basically a nitrate. Now, the blue dots out here is basically a nitrate concentration during the COVID-19 lockdown, and it's at a single point at single time. What we see, there is hardly any change in the nitrate concentration in the river. You know, it's just, you know, a straight line. And that is what you would expect, because nitrate comes from agricultural field. And you will read a lot of newspapers say that the farming activity stopped during COVID-19. Of course, it has stopped. But what about the fertilizers which were there already in the field? They will ultimately come down to the river. So there is no way your nitrate concentrations can change in a matter of 20 days, 30 days, because they all have a residence time. That means it is there in our system and it will be washed. So nitrate concentration during COVID-19 did not really change. Same thing, look at phosphate. Phosphate comes from both agricultural runoff and domestic sewage. There are so many reports says that the phosphate concentration also changed. I mean, it is not really possible because people were still living. The domestic sewage input was same or even more. Agricultural runoff of maybe agricultural farming activities slowed down, but there was fertilizer on the field. They would come. But what really changed was the heavy metal concentrations, because those mostly come from the industries. And what we saw, that almost 50% of the heavy metal concentration decreases on the river after taking into account the volume of the water, the source rock variability. You know, there was quite a lot of scientific analysis that went into it. But nitrate and phosphate concentration did not change at all. So if anyone tells that the because of the COVID-19, the water quality of Ganga improved, that's a really incorrect statement. It only improved certain vitals, but other vitals were, I won't say improved, it's maintained as chemical status quo, whatever was there. Now, whether it's a bad or good, that's the second topic I would come into, come in and discuss. So I would strongly say the statement that COVID-19 pandemic improved all water quality parameter of Ganga River is incorrect. It only improved certain, but rest remained the same. And similarly, 50% reduction was observed. So with that note, I would move to my second gear, where now when we talk about all these water quality parameters, of course, there is this BIS standard of drinking and all. But what about a natural system like river? How do we know that? What are we comparing with? So is there a baseline? I think, sir, as you were saying, the baseline. We don't even have a baseline for the Ganga River. And that's what, you know, we kind of tried. It was an overhauling exercise where, you know, my entire team of postdocs, you know, PhD student, we kind of analyzed 4,000 samples. And this is a, I would say, as an individual PI of a small lab, this was a humongous task. You know, I did not have the network, you know, running each and every tributary, collecting water for 3 years from 2014, 15, 16. 4,000 analyses were done in pre-monsoon, monsoon, post-monsoon. And then we had so much data, and then we actually tried to predict the baseline. And the only idea is when we say that we want to know the baseline, whatever we measure today is disturbed. So let's put it this way. This is the ambient baseline, that it is there today. at least 10 years down the line, we can reflect back to this value so that we can predict what's there in the future. And you will be really surprised to show. And when if you look at this plot, you see on the x-axis, you have headwater, upstream, downstream, and time series. You know, time series is at the same point. Samples were taken again and again. Headwater is above 2,000 meter, more or less the pristine condition. Upstream is the rest of the 2,000 meter, from 2,000 meter to the Rishikesh Haridwar region, and downstream is the Indian floodplain. What we interesting saw, the headwaters have the highest concentration of heavy metals. It is much, much more than, you know, even Farukabad, Kanpur, or, you know, Allahabad. And again, the simple reason is the volume of water there is much smaller. And that's why the weathering rates are so intense, because, you know, it's a really free-flowing, you know, turbulent stream. Of course, you would see such high heavy metal concentration. And again, those concentration out there is geogenic in nature. That means it is caused by nature. But concentrations are there. So anyway, we did a lot of spatiotemporal analysis to see basically how a chemical ion evolves once it's released from Gomu, and then it moves to Bay of Bengal. You know, we almost tracked the ions from its source to sink. You know, it was a really big study, and we see temporal trends and everything. And then from, you know, I am not getting into how we came up with this standard, because we had an extensive data set. And then we actually, you know, proposed the first baseline, and again, the ambient baseline, that is 2016 baseline data for all the heavy metals and all these ions. And we actually compared with all the water major rivers of the world. So our conclusions were, you know, very, very, very distinct. You know, what we say is, of course, we see a lot of heavy metal trace element variability between the source and sink, what that would you expect. And this, again, I would like to say, we have normalized with the discharge value, which means, of course, you know, the volume of water are different at different locations. So everything was normalized in the same volumetric water. So that you can compare a value on the upstream with a value on the downstream, because they are completely different. Upstream has, if it has X amount of water, downstream will have X to the power of 20 amount of water. But they were normalized so that we can compare into one single space. And headwater samples were characterized by the highest concentration of trace metals and so on. But I think what we, you know, what I would strongly say, and, that yes, there are contamination hotspots in the Ganga River. But when we say that the entire river is polluted in terms of heavy metal, that is not really true. What we do, you know, as a, you know, scientist, we try to pick up the samples right from the from an effluent discharge site, you know, right at the, you know, at the point. Of course, you will get very high concentration, but that is not a true representative of the river. You know, the river is really big. The river, you know, kind of rejuvenates itself on its own because of the simple amount of volume of water it is carrying. And if you really look at these 4,000 data points, you know, statistically, they can be actually compared with the global average river water composition. And again, I'm talking all this in terms of the dissolved inorganic heavy metals, trace elements, this sort of thing. I think why there is such a discrepancy between our finding and previous finding is only because we take into account the volume of the water. Without the volume of the water, if you are looking into water quality parameters in the river, that is not the right way to do. So my strong message to the community would be, please look into the volume so that you normalize the volume, and then we can predict what sort of actual quality it is. Maybe it's a BOD. Say, for example, BOD. Now, you have some amount of 5 milligram of BOD in a water, and today it rained heavily. Immediately, that 5 milligram would come down to 2 milligram. So then you will say that the water is good because it is below 3. But actually, the water is not good. You know, the way you measured the 5 is because the volume of the water was low. So these, you know, are very important findings, and we received a lot of good accolades for that from the DST, from the ministry, and not only that, even internationally, you know, this was one of the most highlighted work of this particular journal, which is a very prestigious in our field. It was picked up by multiple international news media. So I think that's I feel that over the 5-6 years, this remove this misconception that our river is the most polluted. Yes, it is polluted at some spots, I think that's not true, because we really need to look into a holistic way of looking at the water, look at the source rock variability, natural rock contribution, so that only we can claim. And when again I say that the water is polluted, it is polluted in terms of a particular element, not maybe for all. So we have to be very careful. So now I think this was more like the science part of my talk. And now, you know, since it's a water tech talk, you know, I thought of, let's go into the tech part. Now, how did we do all this analysis? This is a very complicated, complex, I would, process where, again, a lot of time we overlook, but, you know, it is not a very straightforward way of actually sampling the water. How do you collect? So it's a lot of, you know, training and a lot of kind of precautions that you need to take. And of course, it requires, you know, requires skilled manpower, a proper sampling protocol. Say, for example, you see the number of vials out here these are the parameters that we usually go after. Say, if you are kind of looking at, say, DIC, or, you know, that's DIC is a dissolved inorganic carbon, or a total mercury, the thumb rule is you have to collect water in a glass vial. But if you're looking after heavy metals, you have to make sure that you are using plastic HDPE bottles. And similarly, everyone has their own. Some has to be an amber vial, that is dark color, so that there is no sunlight coming into it. So internationally, protocols, if you really need to follow, they are very complicated. And not only that, you have to make sure that these vials what you're using are very clean. You know, they are pre-cleaned with certain procedure. So it is really a time-consuming matter. And at the end of the day, there is no centralized data management scheme. You know, we are all working on silos here and there in each river basin. And say so, these are extremely expensive. You know, thanks to, you know, government of India that, you know, they have given me all the equipments to measure, but they are expensive. You know, each equipment, you know, cost maybe more than crores to, you know, kind of analyze, to actually process this sort of elemental concentrations. So keeping that in mind, so how do we do it? Say, for example, on my right, you see this is a water quality sonde, you know, which actually measures some of the physicochemical parameters like EC, electrical conductivity, temperature, dissolved oxygen in real time. And this is my observatory at Devaprayag, which is on the confluence of Alaknanda and Bhagirathi. We run this time series station for 2 years. We have to rent a place there. We have to have a trained manpower sitting there. And then what we did is, you know, collect samples every week. And then these are, you know, myself working on the headwaters at very close to Chamoli district, actually, on this one. And then we collect water samples like this, and then we come back to the lab. This is the triple cot ICP-MS in my lab. And there are multiple of them, not this equipment, but there are other equipments like ion chromatography, UVBIS, you know, so on, where we actually use to measure all these things. But again, as you can see, you know, it is not really, you know, it's a very complex way. You go to the field, you have a limited, you know, parameters that you can do in situ, that is right out there. You require some skill to actually collect water sample. Of course, they are expensive. Sometimes they generate a lot of chemical waste if you're doing on-field titration and all these things. And then in the laboratory, you have to, of course, then these are really big parameters in a big, they weigh a lot. You have to, transportation is expensive. Then sometimes you have to properly freeze them. Say, for example, if you're measuring nutrients, you know, nitrate, phosphate, either we have to freeze them within 24 hours or we poison them using mercury chloride. So it's a fairly complicated process that we need to follow to maintain international and national protocols. So, but what is the reality? The reality is just, this is my same water quality probe. Within even 7 to 10 days, these, you know, if you really look into it, this, there's so much dirt, just soil, you know, you need to really calibrate them well. You need to clean them well. So real time is good, but, you know, you really, again, have to, you know, continuously go and monitor and, you know, clean the equipment, clean the sensors. And then you collect water like this, which is not at all recommended. And then they are sitting there in labs for many, because, you know, they are, the turnover time is very long. And then, you know, it's like limited instrumentation at local lab, inaccurate and non-existent field test kits, difficulty sending samples to central lab. And of course, these are expensive. So what we see that to preserve and forward, there is a great opportunity to preserve and forward biochemical information from local lab to the state lab, or from the analytical capacity at a very low cost. So low cost on-site sensor, maybe even more. But there is definitely a demand to bypass this entire process. So here I would come to the next part of my talk that we are actively working on, is the new paradigm, the future. Where are we? We understand the problem. For a researcher like me, this model will still hold. But for a large country like India, this model cannot be the way, because it is not sustainable to do the way we are doing. They are expensive, time consuming, and only you can do limited amount of things with the way I say. So let's look at the future. The future is, there are many ways we can do it. So we have developed this a bottle or a sampling device, whatever you say, which is called the CLEAR. And I'll come to what is CLEAR. So basically, you need to do, when you collect the sample water, when you collect water samples in the field, you basically take bottle water in this bottle, and then you shake in a certain shape. You shake the bottle with water in it, and then you throw away the water. Now, whatever you see here, the brown color is our engineering the kind of resins which can absorb, and then you can simply bypass the entire thing, and using Indian Postal Service, which is huge, you can ship it to us, and then we can measure it. We will actually extract that information, what you see there on the river bank. So in that way, you kind of removing all this requirement of skilled manpower, you're removing the local labs where it has to be sent, you are removing contamination issues, you are removing preserving issues, because this would be preserved. It is designed in such a way. So this is also a way of saying that these are our dry sampling. That means you are not really, you don't have to send a water sample to us. You extract the information from the water, whatever is required, and then come with what parameters we can do. And you just simply use a postcard and send it to us. So, and that is what I exactly say. And the advantage, so we have already patented this. So the advantage of doing this is twofold. So once you put water into it, and then you throw away that water, the water also gets clean, in the sense that your heavy metals and all that we are mostly interested in gets absorbed in this resin. And the water becomes clean of heavy metals. So it's almost a single, a combined water purification and water quality monitoring device, using a single device. So you take water, you throw the water out of it, that water is clean from of these heavy metals, and your resins are holding it back. Now you send me the resins, I can also tell you what was there in your water, the one you were drinking. So it's, I think this is the one we won the Atal Innovation Award for 2019, and we will be soon implementing this. But the concept is dry sampling technology, and we are working with MIT on this particular technology and how it works, because it's a tech talk. I have to tell you how it works, and it's based on the dry blood sampling. So I still remember when my daughter was born in Boston, just after 24 hours, they do a mandatory lead screening on each and every newborn. And it's done here as well. But out there, what they did, they just put a small needle on the feet and took the blood on a dry format like this, because they don't have the luxury to draw 10 ml from a newborn. So it's you need just a drop. So it's basically a dry format preservation of blood. And then they just send this paper to the lab. The lab technicians extract blood out of it, and they measure lead. It's as simple as that. And this is what it's based on. And then this MIT team developed this dry sampling. And then we further took it. And then we have this CLEAR bottle, which is clean, light, easy, reusable, and affordable bottle, which gives you potable water at one hand. So solves a lot of these heavy metal problems, heavy metal contamination problems. But for water quality monitoring is also great, because we can measure them if you send out the resin. So the bottle has an sorbent tailored to relative remove the contaminants from the user water. It's a simple shake and dip and shake technology. No wastewater generation, no requirement of adding chemicals, no requirement of having skilled manpower. You just fill the bottle, check it for 2 minutes, and then your resins will have captured all those. And it almost takes 85% of the heavy metals that is there on the water. And the contaminants can be tailor-made. So if I know your region has some kind of contamination, we can always tailor-made the right amount of resin so that it will remove everything. And of course, flavors and nutrients, they can be added. And this is what basically it shows out here. As you can see, it removes nickel, copper, lead, and almost 85% recovery. And that's great, because at the same time, you also don't want to remove everything, because then the water also goes bad. So 85% removal with 15% in it it's perfect. So if I really tell you, it's a one-step elution procedure, which is required to extract things out of it. So clear bottle will remove dissolved heavy metal cations even in very hard water within 2 to 10 minutes. And it will bring it below the acceptable level. The technology is currently being developed for arsenic. We are working for arsenic. It's a little bit distant. It's a little bit tricky. And of course, we will also work for fluoride and pesticides. So it's almost like analyzing your fluoride, pesticides, arsenic, and heavy metals in a dry format, completely removing this shipping of large bottles, preserving the water with different acids or different poisons. Your water has to be clean. So I think that's really a new paradigm that we will go after. And then it's a much easy manual operation, fill and shake, that I'm saying again and again. Replace the transportation of large amount of water. We don't really want a clear bottle way. Only 1% of what as much is with water. Because you remember, 1 liter is almost 1 kg. So in a region, if you are collecting 100 samples, you're basically shipping 100 kilogram of boxes. That's kind of, and I have done it, so I really know. It's not a pleasant that you come from a field station with 3 months of sample and you have like 300 kg to move from one place to another and take it up to my lab and take it. It's quite a hard task. So said so, I think we are also, that is one aspect of it. And I think where we can really make a difference on this country is something which you have, I'm sure you have heard. It's artificial intelligence based water quality screening device. We called it Padmavati, and a lot of people asked me why Padmavati. Maybe sometime if you have also that question, I'll let you know. It has nothing to do with Padma, but it's just the name that we came up with. So what it basically does, and again, if you really look at the field of instant water quality analysis, these are mostly electrode based. Now, electrode based measurements are very good. There is no doubt in it. But it also comes with a lot of challenges. And the biggest challenges is its calibration. So once you deploy it in a field, the technician has to calibrate again and again before it takes measurements. And also it is restricted to only few parameters. It cannot do for all of them. So that's why we move to a screening device, which may be not as accurate as the electrodes, but it is much better on the long term because we are using simple test strips. I'm sure we all have used test strips in our 9th, 10th chemistry class to measure like acid strength, which is called a litmus paper. You dip it in something, the color changes, and when the color changes, you can quantify what the concentration is. So that's the whole concept behind it. But said so, when I speak to a lot of people, they say, no, that's great, but still you have to understand that a lot of, almost 15% of the people in the world are colorblind. So how do you do it? So that's where we came up with this AI-aided water quality screening device, where we are not really interested on that change. What we do it, we put it inside the box. The box has a very controlled lighting environment. We take a picture. Now we have a database which we have generated. Since we are working on this water quality field, I have almost 10,000 data points for a color and its corresponding value. And that's where all these machine learning algorithms comes into play, where we can predict the concentration almost at an accuracy of 80 to 90%, and which is fair enough. As a researcher, I need precision to understand processes. But for a government agency, they only need to know whether the water is good, bad, or like whether we should drink it or we should not drink it. So as simple as that. We don't need 10^10.34 milligram per liter. We only need to know whether it's permissive limit or below it. So we are 100% it will capture anomalies. It is smart because everything will go into the cloud. Our group's mission is to put this water quality map of India on a digital format. So when everyone does an analysis, it will be automatically transmitted to the cloud, and we will have data analytics and visualization to understand eco-friendly, no wastewater, chemical waste. And currently we are doing successfully for nitrate, nitrite, fluoride, carbonate, free chlorine, ammonia, total chlorine, pH, alkalinity, hardness, which are almost there. And one of the biggest thing that we are doing in collaboration with University of Waterloo, that we are also going for E. coli. I think that would be a really big achievement if we can develop such kind of E. coli sensors in the country. Not only in the country, even in world, there is no such smart device like which can measure E. coli instantaneously, because you understand that for E. coli, you have to do incubation, and that usually takes 24 hours, 48 hours. And here we are talking about instantaneous E. coli detection on doorstep. So it will be very much synced with the Har Ghar Jal mission, where each and every household, and the cost is 1 rupee per parameter. Each and every household person can actually have this, do this at their doorstep, and happy that the water they are drinking is fine. So that is one thing that we are working, and that's what it is. It's on-site, just within 2 minutes. Or E. coli, it would be between 2 minutes to 45 minutes, depending on the concentration. The cost of is rupees 10 per parameter. It should be 1 per parameter. There is an extra zero, but 10 for all the 10 parameters that you see out here. It's a screening test. Of course, you don't expect a 10^3 to 4 value with 1 rupee. For that, if you need, we have the ICP-MS and IC, which costs us 2 crore rupees to purchase and to maintain it, 1 lakh rupees per month. So those are the instrument you should go for. And then it's a smart instant data delivery, cloud storage, advisory on remedial treatment of water, no wastewater, and so on. I think it's an endless amount of benefits that it's there. So my really vision or our group mission is, can we have a Uber, Ola, Swiggy? If I ask you a very simple question, have you ever tested your water in your at your home? And I can assure you 99% of you will say no, including me, who has all the state-of-the-art equipment, because there is no such system in place. Have you ever checked whether your RO is working or not? And it is also a win-win situation for the RO people also, because if they can demonstrate the water is bad, their sales will also go up. So have you really looked into the kitchen sink tank water that is coming is good or bad? We don't know, because there is no such facilities, easy facilities available. So I would really think that this would be a game changer in terms of it will give every citizen of India the power, the vision to actually know the quality of water which they are drinking. And as sir was saying, there are endless diseases, diarrhea. When I went to Kent and Dr. Mahesh Gupta advises us a lot. He says, every other household, there is a problem of diarrhea and, all these diseases, waterborne diseases. So I think this would be really a good thing. Also, we are working on real-time development of water quality parameter, which we call NSVS, which is a Sanskrit name. But it's basically, it can be deployed, as you can see. It's a small nala which we have deployed. It's a buoy basically with all the sensors, real-time sensors, which can transmit data. But again, these are only restricted to only few parameters, EC, dissolved oxygen, temperature, basic parameters. Again, I think these are great, but this is not a deployable thing in masses. These are really expensive ones. And also the problem still remains that you have to calibrate. Even if I deploy, I have to go and make sure that data are calibrating. The other thing that we are working on is automated water quality sampler. Say, for example, how do we turn this water quality sampling automated? That's rather than, I'm going and collecting every day water from the bank of the river. Why not I deploy an automated sampler? And the concept is very, very simple. We just dip it in and then it has a pipe and it takes water in that pipe, and two water samples are basically separated by a bubble, gas bubble. So they are not in contact with each other. It's not there are 10, 100 bottles inside. It is just an elongated pipe where each water sample is separated by a gas bubble. So the idea is when we come to lab, that entire thing can be directly linked to our instrument and it can measure. So one water sample is measured, then the gas bubble and that. You don't have to do anything. So anyway, this is an US SSTF and DST funded project, Indo-US project, which we are working and we will be able to finish the project in next year. But I think I thought, although this is not really water quality, but I think this is so important at today's time, that about the Chamoli district flood. So basically there was a surge of water in the river. So it's very much in the domain of water quality and quantity both. And I see the community is going, trying to find the cause. But just let me tell you, these things will happen in future. Even if we stop climate change, which is a distant dream, these will happen. So only thing what we can do is to, in my personal opinion, to take preventive precautions so that the human lives are not lost. Of course, research will move on. We will come up with multiple hypotheses. It happened with this. It happened because of that. This is the reason. That is the reason. But I think our immediate priority for government of India would be to predict this. And it's a very simple thing to predict. You only have to have a real-time kind of measurement of the water level on those lakes. So this is a perfect example of a glacial lake. And when this breaks, we call this a glacial lake outburst floods. And again, we don't even know whether it's a GLOF in short time we say. But what I'm saying is everything can be monitored real time. And things have really changed over, after 2020. Because, I am also a glaciologist. I work on the glaciers. The biggest problem in working in glaciers is three things. It's very harsh terrain, weather and the rugged topography. And there is no cellular connectivity. So there is the possibility of telemetry is not there. So it cannot be done real time. But with the INSAT, the Indian, the National Satellite System, and with the NB-IoT, which was launched in 2020, I think now we can use satellite to actually have monitoring in this some of the most remote terrains of the world, and we can actually have an advanced flood monitoring system. So whenever they see that there is a sudden drop, say this lake, for example, if the water, the distance between the water and the sensor is 8 meters, and all of a sudden that reduced to 1 meter, that means there is a 9 meter disappearance of water column. And where it will go, it will only come downstream. So it only has to signal to the downstream, and you only need 2 to 3 minutes to evacuate the banks. Of course, the property loss and all this cannot be avoided, but human loss can be really avoided. So I would really say that these are all linked, what I am talking about. Of course, it's not really quality, but quantity and quality, as I said, goes really hand on hand. So said so, my dream and our group's dream is to instantly, accurately, in a very smart way, in low cost, easy to use water quality monitoring devices, so that every Indian household has this sort of device and monitoring and research. We will continue. We will write many good papers. We will, come up with many more solutions. But I think this is really the need of the hour, so that we do it. And of course, I cannot complete my talk. I have beautiful students, very postdocs. I'm just the spokesperson. Of course, you can say, all the hard work they have done, and as much all the funding agency, from DST to SERB, Science and Innovation Research Board, Ministry of Earth Science, IIT Kanpur, Intel, USTF, then Kent is supporting us. So there has been, without them and without my students, I think I would have not been in a position to deliver this talk. So with this, I would really end my talk, and I hope it was clear. And please reach to me in my email address if you have any further questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sushan. Can you tell about a story about the Padmavati?
So the Padmavati was, so when we actually started working on the water quality devices, we thought that we would use electrode-based. And, we started on this using electrodes and everything. Now, they are good. I'm not saying that they are not good or they are not bad. But first of all, they are extremely expensive. A good electrode-based sensor would cost you 5,000 to 10,000 rupees or even more, 15,000, 20,000. Dissolved oxygen would cost you 25,000. And say so, then that's also not the problem. The problem is once you use, so I have all the state-of-the-art electrode-based instruments from abroad and from India. But you have to calibrate them. So if you really give it to your person and he or she has to actually calibrate them in the field using different solutions. So it is, first of all, it is not sustainable and it is expensive. And then we came up with Padmavati, which is basically a test tube-based device. So it basically, once you dip it in water, it changes color based on the concentration. And once it changes color, we actually take an image of that color change and then we earn image processing algorithms. And basically that image processing algorithms takes the color into RGB, which are the primary colors, red, green, and blue. And we have a database where it is mapped with a concentration. And from there, we predict. So it's a mixture of image processing, artificial intelligence, and use of colorimetric assays. And of course, these are smart and it can be really low cost. But again, I would say these are screening devices. You know, you cannot expect that we will be like in a decimal place correct.
Open to questions, please.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone. Before proceeding further, I would like to introduce the format. To ask your query, please click on the icon available on the top right side of your screen to raise your hand option. Once you raise your hand, please wait for your name to be called. Introduce yourself first, your organization name, to ask your query. So we have one query, which is from Mr. Om Pandey, and his query is, if we are measuring concentration of any element in collected water sample, why do we need to normalize it to water volume? Concentration is already calculated by normalization by sample volume.
Yeah, so again, I'll just give you a very easy example. You have one glass of water with 10 ions in it. So your concentration is basically whatever is 10 out of one glass. Now you put that glass of water on a stove and you evaporate half of the water, right? So if you evaporate half of the water, your ion still remains. Still you have 10 ions, but only in half a glass of water. So what I'm saying, yes, concentrations are normalized. That's why we say milligram per liter. But if you just look at that, maybe in summertime, when the water volumes are lowest in rivers, concentration should be theoretically the highest. And it is not because of the pollution. The pollution sources remain the same. But if you just collect water during flood time, so would you say that in the flood there is no pollution? Because, you know, you have so much precipitation that the pollutants gets diluted. So any flood event will have no pollution at all because everything is so diluted. So that is what I'm saying. It is a function of at the same point, in summer time, you will get pollution coming from the same source, but in monsoon times, there is no pollution. But that's not true. The pollution sources is always there, but it's not you're getting it because you're getting diluted.
Okay, yes, then.
Now I request Dr. Sakshi Sharma, you may please ask your query.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Dr. Sakshi from Central Water Commission, and I'm working in the water quality area only. Central Water Commission is having 23 water quality laboratories, and we are monitoring the water quality of all over the Indian rivers. So my first query is, how you're normalizing the heavy metal data with the discharge? I mean, like, technically, how you are normalizing? We are monitoring the discharge as well as the water quality, but we have done this BOD load by measuring the discharge, but never with the heavy metal concentration. So technically, can you please elaborate on that?
Okay, so I think you really need to look into something called C-Q plot, that is a concentration discharge plot. So in a concentration discharge plot, if you just plot it and if you take a regression slope of it, you know, if you have a slope of -1, that's a pure dilution trend. That means whatever concentration you see, it's because of the dilution, whether it's going up or whether it's going down. And a slope of 0 means that volume, that concentration that you measure is not because of any discharge effect or volumetric effect. There are very nice paper, but yeah, just do a little bit of Google search with concentration discharge relationship. You know, these are very standard plots. I can share you the papers, you know, if you are interested. Just write to me, I will share, you know, and you must do it.
Yes, sir, definitely. I have read your recent paper on the lockdown, Ganga, basically on the Ganga. So I was quite interested in it. And the another query, sir, your clear water, that patent, is this in the market or like?
No, they're not in the, they're still in the, you know, research set. So basically these are dry sampling devices, but yeah, it's not in the market yet.
So we are monitoring water quality around at 658 stations. So like I will urge, like you should, like if it is coming in the market or if it is in the process, or we are also the government organization, if you're collaborating with us, it will be a great idea because like, you know, collecting samples every month from the 658 sites creates a huge number of containers. And, yeah.
Absolutely, So why don't please write to me? I think I can get in touch with you. Yeah, that was the entire point. You know, 658 size, and if you're taking 1 liter each, that is 658 kg.
And that too, every month we are doing it.
Every month. And then you have to clean those containers. You have to preserve them well. And, you know, but out here, I'm talking about maybe 2 kg, you know, all the 658 sample, because each of those bottle has 1 gram weight. So basically 268 grams. That's 658 grams, yeah.
This clear bottles are reusable?
Exactly.
Sir, these are reusable, but again, but then the thing is, we are not set to, you know, reusable also has to have a network distribution model. But yes, that's the purpose entirely, which is reusable, because once the bottles comes to us, we can extract the heavy metals out of it. And then those bottles can be again redeployed, because these are fresh regenerated resins, new resins.
So that's why the cost is also so low, because we can use it again and again, at least 20 times for you know, using the same resin again and again.
Now I request Mr. Vimal, you may please ask your query.
Yeah, good afternoon. I'm Vimal Vaklu. I'm the former chairman, managing director of TCIL. And at present, I'm involved with the United Smart Sustainable Cities initiative of the International Telecommunication Union. My question is, you know, for measurement of COD, BOD levels, which are important from the perspective of cleaning our water bodies in cities or the rivers and the rural areas, you know, we need COD, BOD, in fact, chemical transducers, sensors. Are you sort of in the process of making one, or you recommend what are the right sensors? Because the one which are available internationally costs about $30,000, which is a ridiculous price.
Yeah, so I think we really don't work on the COD, BOD sensors. But of course, my reading also, you know, we are on the almost the same page, because I think that's a real need. But we really don't have such sensors that are low cost and which is reliable, same as E. coli. But I think that's on our do list. But I understand, you know, I've been to several meetings that I, you know, I hear about COD, BOD sensors. But yes, there is no such solution as of now. These are all lab-based measurements that what we are doing. And again, the same problem, you know, large wait time. Yeah, these are incubation based. So yeah, I won't be able to comment much on the COD, BOD, because that's really not my domain.
Okay. You also mentioned about the sensors. You know, you mentioned about the measuring the water bodies near the glaciers, the rise in the water levels.
Yes.
To prevent catastrophes, the one we saw in Uttarakhand recently.
Yes.
Why can't we also have mechanical, seismic transducers installed near these glaciers, so that whenever the tectonic shift takes place, these can be monitored and advanced action for helping people in rescue operations can be undertaken.
Absolutely. I think that's, but I think as a glaciologist, I think, as I said, three challenges are there. First of all, the terrain is very rugged, harsh weather. And as on date, there is no telephone connectivity. So whatever measurement happens, we cannot have telemetry. But in 2020, we have these satellites which can be used to data transmission.
Exactly, because now the satellite, low orbit satellites are available.
Exactly.
Which can easily take these measurements. And this is a must for any country with such terrain.
Yes, and these will happen. You know, if I give you a few statistics, every year, almost there is a 15 square kilometer of expansion in the lakes, which are existing. And if you just look at Eastern Himalaya itself, 41 new lakes formed, new lakes. So every year there are new lakes forming. It's almost like a bomb sitting out there. One day they will accumulate enough water and it will come down. And this flood particularly is even a special one. Usually the flooding happens because of the monsoon season. So that's why we call it a glacial lake outburst flood. This one is even a dangerous one because it was a perfect day. There was no rain event over the last one month. But still there was this, you know, flood. So it is not really the rainfall which triggers. There are other reasons also, maybe seismic driven. So what I'm trying to say, that don't think that our danger is only restricted in the monsoon month. It can happen 365 days. So we need to install such things.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
Now I request Mr. Shyam Behmani. You may please ask your query.
Yeah. Hello, sir. This is Shyam Behmani, third year undergraduate at IIT Kanpur.
Yeah, Shyam, tell me.
Sir, I had a question about that platypus water sampling system that you have developed.
Uh-huh.
As far as I could understand from the talk, it is based on resins which capture the water contents, right?
Yes.
So, sir, if there is a new contaminant which cannot be captured by the resin, like how would you propose we tackle that or detect that?
Shyam, I think contaminants from water, there can be million of them. You have to understand that one solution can cater to million. These are specific. Say, for example, water is, you know, it's very kind of, it's little bit easy to predict. Say, for example, where there is arsenic pollution, there is only arsenic. There is no chromium, there is no lead. So on those regions, we can only focus on such a solution which can only remove arsenic. But similarly, if you have a fluoride problem, there is only fluoride is an issue. Arsenic is not an issue. So it has to be tailor-made for that particular region. It, one solution cannot really clean all of them. So I think my answer was really clear. So yeah, if you are talking about, say, pesticides, you know, these things cannot remove pesticides. We cannot measure them. But I'm sure there are different research groups in the country which are coming with such solutions for pesticide. You know, our expertise is only on the heavy metals, on the inorganic aspects. But there are so many organic pollutants as well, we don't even touch. And there was one like important, like,
I'm Uday Shankar and I work at an organization called Water Aid India and I'm based in Delhi. You explained very well the seasonality factor that dilutes water. Like you explained very well that concentration will be higher in case of high temperature and if there are flood or like a more rainfall, the concentration will be lower. In that case, I'm referring to one specific area of a problem, like a groundwater quality problem, where, like, for example, fluoride, certain pockets of a country have excess fluoride because of weathering of rocks. And in those areas, the same principles can be applied or to dilute the water so that at least it's manageable or within certain pockets, it's within the manageable region of concentration. Like 10 ppm of fluoride is very high, so it reduced to reasonably low, so that at least people can use potable water for drinking. So any experience, because this is a large experiment, we can think about a plan and certain pockets where near a source dilution takes place and quality is like elevated contamination level or chemical presence can be reduced to certain extent. it could be a large experiment, but we need a really good evidence to that it works. And it will save like a cost of testing testing also, so that people can benefit. Any experience can you share on that?
No, I don't have such experience, but the theory is simple. If you really know your recharge aquifer, and if you just have, and your recharge aquifer may be very far, and if you just recharge the aquifer at there, and if you add more water to your aquifer, confined or unconfined, your solution, your concentration will go down. It's like, you are putting more water, you have X amount of concentration and then you are adding clean water to it. You just simply dilute it. So solve, problem will be solved in theory. I don't know how feasible it would be actually on do in the field, but if your reservoir is 100 liter and if you put 100 more liter, your concentration simply reduces by half.
Mr. John Thomas, you may please ask your query. Ms. Nupur Bahadur, you may please ask your query.
Hello, good afternoon. Dr. Sen, it was a wonderful lecture and very insightful. I have one question. That particularly with regard to 2-3 ions which you mentioned, so how is the selectivity and sensitivity ensured?
Which ones you are talking about for the Padma?
Particularly we talk of fluoride and arsenic, so among the two, how can we have the selectivity and sensitivity for two ions in single measurement?
Yeah. I think that's a very good question. So we actually have an ongoing project funded by Kent, where we are actually trying to develop our own, own arsenic sensors, which are also missing not only in the country, in the world. And the major problem we saw is basically the selectivity. The ones which react with arsenic 5 is also maybe reacting with iron. There are many, gold nanoparticles are there, but we will share a very good news with you very soon, where we will develop our own molecule which will be very specific to arsenic. But yeah, it's a very important problem, and we can only test looking at with different solutions. That's what we are doing.
And thank you. And regarding you mentioned very interesting point just now, that when we look at the wastewater, the BOD, COD and organics are very crucial. So just to let you know, if we can collaborate in future, I'm working as senior scientist in Terry, and we are working on advanced oxidation technologies like photocatalysis and photoelectrostatic membrane reactors for treating organic pollutants in real wastewaters for industrial wastewater and municipal sewage treatment. So this
I wish to ask about a slightly different subject. Have you any view on the possibilities of using remote sensing for understanding river quality? Temperature, color, turbidity, eutrophication. These are things that can be studied through remote sensing. And they will tell about river more than only about water. What's your view?
Yeah, so I think, again, as you said, this is really beyond my domain of expertise, but I know my few of my colleagues who are working on it. But my view is nothing can replace an actual real measurement on the ground. Nothing, no matter how advanced the system is. Particularly the remote sensing, as you said, it mostly uses different color bands, and turbidity is a one parameter, chlorophyll content is one important parameter. But getting into contaminants like chromium concentration, lead concentrations, I don't think so we do have. Again, I may be wrong because I'm not up to date on that field, but I don't think so. In my opinion, there are technologies which can actually go into this kind of levels, that what is the E. coli content of the water? What is the nitrate concentration of the water? Yes, productivity, you know, kind of chlorophyll count and all this can be figured out, I assume, but not into the extent that we are looking at. But at the end of the day, nothing can beat actually a real measurement on ground.
Water basically like nutrients, which due to that more amount of algae production is there or biodegradable waste space, then what can be the economical solution for that particular water bodies?
Okay, again, I'm not really what can be the solution, but it's again, as you said, it's a most common problem. We call it in scientific term algal bloom. If you have more nutrient, there would be more. But, you know, again, this is only I hear when I listen to others talk. There are water hyacinths which can take this nutrient. You have to really cut down the nutrient source, which are mostly, you know, comes from fertilizer runoffs. So if you can cut down your nutrient source, I think that's the only way you to economically control. Otherwise, you have to go for a lot of pre-treatment and all, which I don't know what are they. But yeah, what can be done is to figure out where your nutrient is coming from. That comes under my expertise domain. And then cut down the source as much as possible, rather than polluting it and then trying to clean it.
I request Ms. Sophia Khan, you may please ask your query. Ms. Sophia Khan, you may please ask your query. So there is one query which is from Ms. Swatali Panda, and her is that we are working on sensor technology to develop for water quality measurement.
So the question is, we are working on sensor technology to develop for water quality. Currently, we are focusing on to develop sensor for. Yeah, I think that's the need of the hour, developing sensor for arsenic. We are also working and get in touch with me. We can share, you know, exchange thoughts for how we are doing. But it's a very important problem. And there is no such solution available in the market. There are a lot of research papers, but in my experience is research paper and actually a device which actually work on the field, there is a gap between the two. We tried to, you know, reproduce many of the research papers, but they were not really successful. Or maybe we were doing wrong, you know, that's also a possibility. But as on that, we don't have a sensor such, you know, which can detect arsenic right on spot without producing any. Of course, there are some, but in that you are producing arsine gas. Which you don't want, you know.
Arsenic burning. We find that the because of poor extraction of water, the arsenic is very is increasing. So if any of you are doing good research in the field, please inform us also. National Water Mission is on the loop, because the mission director is heading that interministerial committee in the national level. I just want for information. We could be a platform for all of you exchanging ideas and thoughts about arsenic, mitigation of arsenic. Thank you.
I request Mr. Barun Thakur, you may please ask.
Hello. Sorry, it was very insightful talks. So my question is that arsenic is available in +3 and +5 stage. So how you can remove both the stage in one resin? And if it works, then how you can regenerate the resins?
So are you talking about its detection or its removal? Because only one of them is poisonous, you know, the arsenic 5, right? So, you know, you don't really need to remove the other one. If you can remove the carcinogenic species, I think that is good enough.
But sir, the WHO level for drinking is around 10 ppb. So how can you remove that arsenic 3? Because arsenic 3 and arsenic 5 all are coming in groundwater.
Yeah, exactly. So that's what I'm saying. So, you know, if you know these, how these technologies work, these are called ion exchange resins, right? So it will only bond to a particular species. So you have to really tailor-made your resin in such a way that it will only remove one particular species. Now, then you have to find one more other resin if you want to remove the other ones. So that's a way to go.
And second question, how can you regenerate it after...
Regeneration is a very simple process, and we do it routinely using in column chromatography, where these are kind of as an ion exchange thing. An ion starts exchanging when there is a different pH medium. So when you put in a small, say, a 3 normal hydrochloric acid or 6 normal hydrochloric acid, the EH-VH condition of the column changes. And it will immediately release. Ion extract on lead isotope, we look at the isotopic copper resin and discard everything. And then we actually elute the lead in a pure form from water or from soil or whatever. These are very standard routine. You know, there's no big science. Well, of course, someone who has developed the method has a lot of invested, but these are routine methods with which you can do it.
Because I worked with from IIT Kharagpur, I was researched there.
Yeah.
So I did work on different type of arsenic removal from the groundwater in different types of regions at West Bengal. So and right, we have tested different types of pH for the removal of arsenic and for the removal of fluorides. So in the same water, if fluoride and arsenic is available, so what will be the pH? How you maintain the pH so that you can remove both arsenic and fluoride in one water?
Yeah, so I think Varun, right? So Varun, my expertise is not really you are looking into aquifer level, right? There have been lot of research work that has been done in arsenic, and a good, even in IIT Kharagpur, there is Abhijit Mukherjee's group, who are almost a leader on that field. I think I would say please get in touch with him. So much has been done in arsenic. I think that's the most well studied. I think, but what we are focusing on it's detection. That's where we need, some really nice technology or nice sensors to come up with. Not its removal. I think there are almost like 10, 15 methods of removing arsenic. Again, there are many experts in this country, and please get in touch with them. But I think our focus is more on its detection. And there are many ways, skiff-based things can react. But as someone was saying, selectivity and sensitivity, these are very important things that we need to take care of.
Okay, thank you, sir.
I request Mr. Sen.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, I would like to first of all thank everyone, the organizers and the esteemed Mr. Sen for giving us this opportunity to be present in such an insightful and truly informative session. I am Ananti from Class 8, Kolkata, and I just wanted to ask a very simple question. Mr. Sen, you recently spoke about varying indicators for multiple pollutants, right? So for those, what do you think would be more economic, or like what is being planned, bio indicators or mechanical tools as such? And in regards to what another attendee just asked, how are we going to determine that one removing substance or element would be able to remove a certain pollutant that exists in more than one biochemical level? So like, are we going to have separate indicators for all the levels, or will we introduce to one single indicator that would help us identify all the levels of one pollutant? I understand my question is quite childish in comparison to all the detailed questions that everyone asked, but...
said, so sometimes you really don't need individual every parameter to detect one. If the presence of one is detected, the other usually stays. But there are also cases like where arsenic is there, may not be fluoride is there. So, you know, I think there is no such direct answer to your question. But yes, to answer your first question, I think I would say biological, you know, when I talk to experts and, you know, my advisors and everyone, there are two things. When you talk about heavy metal pollution, contamination, as Sir was speaking, stunted growth and all, these are really long term. If you drink a water of above permissible limit, one or two, nothing will happen. But if you really drink water enriched in E. coli, you will immediately feel it. You know, you will feel very sick. So one has a long-term effect. It is acting as a slow poison. And the other has short-term effect. So I think both are equally important the way you look at it. Yeah, if you are drinking slow poisoning, you know, going through slow poisoning every day, that is also not desired. And, you know, going through a E. coli rich, drinking a E. coli rich water or in a cis-rich, amoebic-cis-rich water is also not desired. So there is no such direct answer to your question. It's almost a hypothetical answer I would give.
So we don't have more hand raised right now. We have a query in chat, which is from
Thomas.
I request to John Thomas. You may ask your query.
So is my internet unstable, or I think the internet is unstable on your side?
I think it's unstable here. I also have a break in the when the comparer takes it up.
Okay.
Anyway, any questions? Any more questions?
No questions.
Okay. Now, we were talking about the detection of E. coli. Can you a little bit elaborate on that? Because this would be very, very fundamental for the disease load, and then for when we have this Jal Jeevan mission, this would be probably the most important thing. Is there anything you can really elaborate on that?
Yeah, I think as I said, with water, when we have figured it out. It based on based on enzymatic reactions, and with there's a altogether paper and patent, everything together. But yes, I think that is really would be the game changer, in the terms that is the most important aspect. And when I talk to a lot of people, they say that this is what the country actually requires. You know, if you have something like this. So what we have seen is the reaction happens. Again, it depends what you have. We have developed, we are working in collaboration to develop few things. One is, as you say, a litmus paper. You dip it in, and between 2 minutes to 45 minutes, it will change color, depending on what is your level of E. coli, you know, in the water. Of course, the more it is, detection would be fast on, and the lower counts, it is higher. And then also we have other technologies which can actually go to really low levels. And these can be all done doorstep. But yeah, for the dip test, we call it dip test. That is the one which can be done really instantaneously without any skilled operators. So yes, I think that is, I have two kind of plans or vision, you can say. One is to do this. And I really would like that even you can actually get your water analyzed at your home. Going through different things, the way we order, should be able to depend on its solution. So that's, I think, I would like to go after in the next 5 years.
Actually, that is very important because, see, one very major problem which is coming out is the extensive use of RO. The RO technology has really now entered into almost every household. And this is actually, in now many research have proved that it is actually harmful to the health because it removes a lot of tedious, and then the water which is we are taking is actually salt hungry. So it takes from our body. So osteoporosis has also an increase. So many things have been associated with the extensive use of RO. Logically speaking also, it is very, it is not very prudent to have an RO fitted because the water, because I was also heading a long Hyderabad Metro Water Company supply long back. So we are actually supplying water which is a lot of value added. We pick up water from some source like a river in Krishna River or Godavari River in Hyderabad. We transport it, do a lot of process on it. We clean it, do ultraviolet radiation, and then the water which comes out from the distribution point is very, very clean, extremely good water, very much potable. But the issue is when this water is now taken to the house and we take it through an RO, which removes a lot of salts and then gets us very, very, very probably, I would say, water which is depleted of many minerals. Now, I was asking many utilities, can you do a campaign for doing away with RO? Can you certify? But then the utilities have been telling that we can certify that the water quality at the output of our source. But these pipelines generally go through many, sometimes through sewage lines and sometimes through the various drains, which also has sewage in it or stormwater drains. And in Indian cities, most of the places we have either alternate day supply or even if you have a daily supply, it is not a 24-hour supply. It's 24-hour, water is not available. So the water, when the water is supplied, the water goes. To the pipe and then stop. Maybe in the water distribution network is of course not supplying water 24 hours. Now the water gets sitting in between and not able to ensure or certify that the water which is coming up is 100% pure every time. So in that context, probably material the litmus test you have been searching, that would be very essential. So then we can do away with the RO. If the test says that, okay, the water is okay, they can drink. If it is not good, so we can change it. Then we probably connect RO. Instead of connecting RO 24 hours and 80-60% of the water is lost. This is a huge waste of loss because the water which is value added, which is purified and sent to the house, 60% is reject of RO. And so it's a huge waste of water. So there's something. This is something which we should look at it. And this test of litmus would be very, very useful. I think it's something brilliant idea if we can work out and make it very cheap and available across. And also, if they can do this, as I said in the image, they can send it by iPhone or something. They take a picture of it and send it and upload it, and then
absolutely,
that would be something great.
That's the next thing. And also, sir, I think I will just quickly add. As you were saying, you know, your source node is clean, but, you know, it goes through a lot of pipelines. And the classic example is the Flint lead pollution disaster, which happened in US, where lead actually seeped in for old pipelines. So that is possible. So that's why at the end of the day, for you to be satisfied, you really need a doorstep, you know, at your tap. You know, because as you say, the pipeline goes from here, you don't know from where it is coming from. But say, so if you have such a device, you say, for example, I have a RO installed, you know, the RO with UV, with HD, you know, all parts of combination. Maybe I don't even require it. But since it's just in the mindset that, you know, we put it. And at the same time, a lot of people who don't want to put it, maybe their water is bad. So it is win-win, I think, for both. You know, an RO company can also figure out that where RO is really required, so the you know it's easy for them to convince, okay, use RO. And at the same time, where RO is not required, like you know, maybe in my you know my water connection in IIT Kanpur, I really don't need RO. But since there is no way, we just install the best possible RO there and wastewater and also you know damage our health. You know, as you say, the TDS and all this going down. So I think it would be a great addition if we can do it. We will do it, or it's just a matter of time.
मैं वर्चुअल तहे दिल से सबका हार्दिक अभिनंदन करता हूं। इस वाटर टेक टॉक के माध्यम से हमने जल क्षेत्र में शामिल तकनीकी के बारे में एक खुले और रचनात्मक संवाद से आप सभी के साथ जुड़ने की कोशिश की है। आज मुझे आशा ही नहीं अपितु पूरा विश्वास है कि आप सभी ने वाटर टेक टॉक के सत्र के साथ साथ आज के हमारे मुख्य वक्ता डॉक्टर इंद्रशेखर सेन जी द्वारा साझा किए गए अनुभव का भी आनंद लिया होगा। आप सब लोगों की तरफ से मैं हमारे आज के वक्ता डॉक्टर इंद्रशेखर सेन जी की भी भूरी भूरी प्रशंसा करता हूं, जिन्होंने हमें पानी की गुणवत्ता जांचने और परखने के लिए जो नए प्रतिमान और नई तकनीकी आई है उसके बारे में हमें बखूबी बताया। जल की गुणवत्ता जांचने और परखने के लिए वैज्ञानिक तरीकों का उपयोग कैसे होता है वह इन्होंने बहुत ही सहज और सरल तरीके से बताया। कि इन्होंने एक पद्मावती इक्विपमेंट के बारे में बताया कि वो एक बहुत ही इंस्टेंट एक्यूरेट स्मार्ट लो कॉस्ट इजी टू यूज वाटर टेस्टिंग इक्विपमेंट है। इसका इंस्टेंट डेटा डिलीवरी है, क्लाउड स्टोरेज है एंड द कॉस्ट इज ओनली 1 रुपीज पर पैरामीटर। इतना अच्छा ढंग से इन्होंने इसके बारे में बताया और इसको कैसे उपयोग करते हैं उसके बारे में बताया और जो इसके पीछे तकनीकी है वो तकनीकी के बारे में बताया कि इट इज रीपर्पजिंग आयन एक्सचेंज रेजिन्स फॉर क्वांटिटेटिव प्रिजर्वेशन एंड रिकवरी ऑफ हैवी मेटल्स। मैं डॉक्टर सेन के बारे में ये भी बताना चाहता इनकी मिनिस्ट्री के पास। मैं सभी उपस्थित लोगों को वाटर टेक टॉक के सत्र में शामिल होने के लिए आज यहाँ पर हमारे वक्ता की हौसला अफजाई करने के लिए और इस सत्र में पूरे उत्साह विश्वास और ऊर्जा के साथ हिस्सा लेने के लिए धन्यवाद करता हूँ। मैं नेशनल वाटर मिशन के इस वाटर टेक टॉक के आयोजन में पूरा सहयोग देने के लिए टीम वाटर डाइजेस्ट को भी धन्यवाद करता हूँ। इस वाटर टेक टॉक को सार्थक और एक शानदार कार्यक्रम मनाने के लिए आप सभी को धन्यवाद। मैं अब ज्यादा समय न लेते हुए आज के धन्यवाद प्रस्ताव को यहीं समाप्त करता हूं और आखिर में मैं कहना चाहूंगा वही देश बनेगा महान जहां होगा जल का सम्मान। वी शुड पे अवर ड्यू रिस्पेक्ट टू दी वाटर। और अंतिम में मैं क्योंकि पानी होगा तो आप पानी की क्वालिटी के बारे में बात करेंगे तो इसके लिए हमें जल संरक्षण के लिए हमारे अपर सचिव और मिशन डायरेक्टर जी का एक मानना है कि डॉन को पकड़ना मुश्किल ही नहीं बल्कि नामुमकिन है और बारिश को पकड़ना बिल्कुल नहीं है और एकदम मुमकिन है। इसलिए वी ऑल शुड प्रमोट एंड प्रैक्टिस रेन वाटर कंजर्वेशन एंड ऑल्सो सपोर्ट आवर कैंपेन ऑन कैच द रेन वेर इट फॉल्स व्हेन इट फॉल्स व्हिच इज कैंपेन ऑर्गेनाइज बाय नेशनल वाटर मिशन। दैट्स ऑल फ्रॉम माय साइड। शुक्रिया। जय हिंद।
जस्ट वन वर्ड। वी कंटिन्यू आवर वाटर टेक टॉक एवरी सेकेंड फ्राइडे। अगले सेकेंड महीने के सेकेंड फ्राइडे में भी वाटर टॉक रहेंगे। वी ऑल्सो हैव द वाटर टॉक ऑन एवरी थर्ड फ्राइडे। तो अगले फ्राइडे को